estaría en punto.
Okay, I claim then that automorphism of C hat acts on one point transitively, but not really. You can show that. And I claim that on pair of two ordered points, it also acts transitively, but not really. But on three points, it is. So that means that if I have Z2, Z3, and Z4, and I want to push it to W2, W3, and W4, then T will exist and it's unique. So T for Z I, okay. Let us prove uniqueness of existence. And then we need to to prove that I can that I have the repeat exist T such that for Z2, Z3, Z4 it goes to 0, infinity and 1. 0, 1 and infinity. No, 0, infinity and 1. Okay. And well, I can just introduce such a T and it will be
If the triangles don't have the same angles, how could it take it one triangle to the other triangle?
What?
I think you're discussing the action of GL2.
Yes.
And GL2 does not act by automorphisms because you do allow stretches, right?
Yes. Such defined cross ratio preserves length. One more time question. Not triangles, but the mark.
If the triangles don't have the same angles, how could it take one to another and preserve angles in straight lines?
I mean,
because it's not you think you're thinking of regular lines.
No. No, but no, they like two boyfriends.
No,
so.
No, I think we are making a mistake here.
When we speak about the automorphism of the hyperbolic plane, we don't look at GL2C but on GL2R or a PG or a PSL2R. And this group acts simply transitively on triples of point at infinity.
So what do they preserve?
And they preserve the hyperbolic structure. Still, what happened in this adjacent to C?
No, I mean, I claim that the defined cross ratio as is invariant under everything from that list. So
I think there was now I'm a bit confused myself, but you started with discussing upper half planes and geometry of these and and transformation that do preserve the angles. Later on you moved to discuss automorphism of C hat.
Yes. And
which is
And they don't preserve the do they preserve the angles?
They preserve angles.
So can they do they preserve the lines?
They also preserve lines.
Generalized lines.
Yeah. They preserve
the hyperbolic
lines. They preserve spheres.
So you cannot take by Mobius transformation
zero
in infinite and one are on the same line. They're on the same sphere.
So they don't preserve the lines?
Yeah, they preserve the sphere, not upper half plane. But
okay.
This is not the group of.
Everything is written, which is written here is correct. I think our interpretation was misled by the two discussion. There is discussion of a hyperbolic plane, discussion of the complex sphere, the Riemann sphere, which is different. So if you have these three points, Z1, Z2, Z3, and I guess in your mind you want to complete the geodesic triangle between them.
Yeah.
This is something which is, I mean, it's not, it doesn't make sense actually inside C hat.
In C hat, there are many, there are plenty of lines. I mean, okay. C hat, you can consider it as the boundary at infinity of the three dimensional disk of the Poincaré disk. So this is the boundary of the three dimensional hyperbolic space. If we consider the two-dimensional, the plane, then we look at then there is either the circle or R plus infinity, and then the group of transformation that is PSL2R, the trill coefficient.
Okay.
And this group acts simply transitively on triples of points on the line at infinity. They don't act simply transitively on triple of points inside the hyperbolic space. And then there is no ambiguity. Every triple of points on the line of infinity defines what is called ideal triangle. It's a triangle that all the angles are zero. So then you can move. If you understand what I mean, there is this line at infinity, and if you have 3 points here, then there is a triangle, but all the angles are zero.
Yes.
And you can move such. And then there is no ambiguity of what you ask.
Are you going to discuss the action of SL2R on the hyperbolic plane, on the upper half plane?
On C hat, you don't have geodesic.
Okay, so let me stop and make a remark that I think will clarify something. I think we should go and discuss. So here is a C hat. C, actually it's in C hat, but I will not draw infinity. That's C, and GL2C act on this in on C head in the way we described before, and but that X line, let me redraw it in red. The X line is actually the real line inside it, and this is preserved by SL2R. Preserve this, and in fact, if you take a point here, I'm claiming that also it preserved the complement of SL2R. Oh, sorry, of the plane. So it preserved either this or that piece. But since this group is connected, it must preserve also. I mean, it must actually preserve each of them.
But
because
still, I don't understand.
Yeah.
So
if you take, I'm about to explain.
Ah, okay.
Now, in here, the claim is that we haven't proved yet, is that in the upper plane, if I have a triangle, the claim is geodesic, and Anna explained what are geodesics before, are preserved. I mean, a geodesic goes to a geodesic. In particular, if I have a triple of points, I can draw the corresponding geodesics, and I guess this is a bad drawing.
Does it preserve angles also?
It does preserve angles, and any element will take it again to another such thing. Any element of SL2R will take it to another such thing with similar angles.
But how can you take it to every 3 points?
You cannot. No, but GL2C does not preserve the upper half plane. It does not preserve the real line, of course, because you have complex matrices. And it does not preserve geodesics,
okay.
So it will take these 3 points into another triple, but it will not take the geodesic triangle into the geodesic triangle.
Okay. SL2R does preserve the geometry, so there are angles, but there are also lengths. So SL2R acts and preserves the geometry and the lengths, but it doesn't act simply transitively on triples in the plane, it acts simply transitively on triples in the boundary, in the line.
Okay.
So Anna started a discussion with a description of the hyperbolic plane, but we moved now to describe C hat and its own conformal geometry, which is something else. It is, by the way, related both to, in some obvious way, it's not equal, but it is related to the two-dimensional geometry. But also there is a relation to a three-dimensional hyperbolic geometry, which we haven't discussed. A three-dimensional hyperbolic geometry is happening, a model of it is in a ball, in a three-dimensional ball, and that sphere over there is its boundary at infinity. This is what Tsarik mentioned. But this is only slightly related to the first half of the...
Yeah, but at least
first
it's
half.
Good to
no,
make
the
this...
Idea.
It's so just a remark which... The sphere, this sphere, the two-dimensional sphere, is can be realized as the boundary of the three-dimensional hyperbolic space, and the group of conformal transformation of the sphere happens to be exactly the group of isometry of the hyperbolic plane, which is exactly this group of matrix transformation, which is PSL2C, and this is an interesting fact for group theorists. I mean.
But so far we haven't seen this.
We haven't seen this, but since okay, sometimes we give advanced lectures. So this group, okay, and it's related to PSL2 QP and so on. And when we study it as a group, it's good to know that it's a group of isometry, a group of conformal transformation, but it's also a group of matrices that we can change the field and go from real to complex to periodic and realize results about subgroups of such. Anyhow, this is the remark.
Can
you
state a proposition again? Just what proposition? About C hat?
Automorphism of C hat.
Which
X.
Conformal automorphism?
Is a conformal.
Yeah.
Is a conformal, and X transitively and freely on 300 different points. Actually, the idea was, I probably should have thought about that. The idea was that we have some models and we I describe some lines, I describe some angles, and then I say, okay, it is not enough to talk about geometry. So I go to all automorphism of C, and after building it, I say that, okay, in miraculous way, I can then, by then, define automorphism of disk and automorphism of upper half plane. And then, also by miraculous way, after I will define what is metric and what are geodesics like rigorously, I will say that, okay, that is also isometry. So maybe that is not straight. Okay, so.
Just to summarize, now the geometry that is preserved is only the angles, not lengths of segments, which are not defined.
Okay, so existence of such transformation. Well, I can. It is enough for me to show that that one exists because of. Also, you can show that inverters exist. So, if you want to go from Z1, Z2, Z3, Z4 to W2, W3, W4, you go to 0, 1, infinity, 0, infinity, 1, and then from here you go to here. That's strange way, but I mean, showing the exact formula for that transformation is, well, almost obvious, because we want to have some zeros, okay, so we need to have 0 in here. We want to have some infinity, okay, we need to have infinity in here. We want to have one, okay, we just do something else. Yes?
The two in the end?
Yeah.
Bottom right?
What?
The denominator.
Z minus Z2, that must be 2, I don't know why that's strange. Okay, so. And now I write that my desirable transformation is t minus 1
Is 3 the best you can? Can you do 4? Is it possible to do 4? Because you were saying that in the case of the two spaces, then you're acting transitively on triples of points.
Simply transitive.
You cannot do 4. But this is now, I'm going up one dimension. So this is like, I'm just wondering, because now I'm in the sphere around.
No, in the sphere you act simply transitively on triple the sphere.
But it's not on.
If you restrict to the line, if you look at the transformation of the sphere that preserves the line,
mm-hmm.
it's exactly Pearson 2L.
Yeah.
So.
But this PSO 2C preserves the boundary of hyperbolic free space.
Yes.
So we're saying now it acts on, again, you have simply transitively on triples in the boundary.
Yes.
This way of
yeah.
looking at this.
Yeah.
But it could you say, well, that I'm just saying, because you went up at a dimension, so
yeah,
it might
yeah.
be natural to act on, so instead of triangles, you would have like tetrahedrons.
No,
you
don't have to simply transitively on focus.
The cross section shortened.
Yes.
Yeah.
The cross section in the cross section of 4 points. Yeah.
Yes.
Stable and,
actually, it is exactly the.
Yeah.
It's unique invariant. You give them a triple, you act on two quadruple of points on the Riemannian sphere. You can take one to another if and only if they have the same cross section.
Uh-huh.
using this.
Looking at that and defining that as persuasion, you also can see that these three are obvious again, because you add value. Mm-hmm. Plus t minus minus t is zero, and you that need to be defined that that is the same as to every, and then you need to, I don't know, have 2 minutes of writing to show that inversion works, and you run. Okay, that was existence, that was cross-racial uniqueness. If I have C, and C of zero. Of infinity is infinity, and C of 1 is 1, then C is identity. That could be sort of like if you fix 3 points, you fix everything. S of Z has obviously form of AZ plus B. So if S is 0, then B over D is 0. That is okay. S of infinity is infinity. Then A over C is infinity. So B C is 0. And we also have, so we have like A, B, 0, 0, and we also can say that, okay, we also want to have the determinant of S is 1.
Why do we have the determinant?
Well, we wanted it non-zero for being GL to C. And now I'm truly want to preserve distance of here.
She's already remarked that as far as the axiom of fractional linear transformation is concerned, we can ignore the scalar matrices, so we might as well work with PSL to C. So that's why the determinant is 1.
Well, yes, I mean, at that point, I'm somehow saying that, okay, I want to be bounded, like, here.
Hmm? No.
Plugging in
no,
1
no,
just
what
gives
what
you A over D plus 1.
What's the question?
So why is determinant 1?
I don't know why determinant 1.
No, because
T is not well defined, T to 3 depends by Z to 3.
No. Now, here the claim is that if you have any automorphism of C hash which fixes 0, 1 and infinity, then it is the identity.
Right.
And she has already remarked earlier that automorphisms of C hat are precisely PSL to C.
So do we know, like, if we look at T 2, 3, 4, we want the determinant to be 1 also, what is it? So we need to, like,
you
know, put a lambda times there. Maybe if we're restricting to determinant equals 1,
yes.
So maybe we should check that the determinant of T is also 1. And in order to do that, I think it depends on the point. So we might need to have a constant times Z.
But T...
Can you restrict it?
T is someone that push z1 to w1. So
I'm not sure you can actually tell.
Combination.
So how do you know the determinant of t is 1?
Are you sure you can restrict it?
Well, if I have a combination of three.
Maybe you can't restrict it, yeah. So how do you know it's 1?
I think the question of the one thing is not related here. I mean, a Möbius transformation doesn't have a determinant, strictly speaking, right? I mean, it's we can represent it using a matrix, but we can represent it using matrices in many ways. And those representations will have
different
determinants.
Yeah. Okay.
And there is a claim, which is very, very easy, that we can always represent it, actually in two ways, with matrices of determinant 1.
Oh my.
Okay.
In C is one.
We are in C, yeah.
So we're looking at different ways to look at
And the claim is just,
yeah.
I mean, algebraically is PSL2C equals PGL2C. I mean, if you take GL2C and divide by the center, the image of SL2 will be everything. And maybe I'll just say how to go. Take any Möbius transformation, take anything in PGL2C, take a representative, so representative as A, B, C, D matrix, compute the determinant, maybe it's not 1, take the square root of what you got, and divide the matrix by this square root. The determinant of this new matrix will be now 1, but it will represent the same object in the Möbius transformation.
I was trying to claim that, well, if we have that, and T is could be represented as
So the claim is that every T could be represented.
Yes. Well, that was like exercise, probably.
Yeah.
Must have been. Okay, and if I have that, and I can present then I can counter determinant. So, I mean, you're not sure, but you can keep in mind, like simultaneously, that formula and that method. Okay, 0, infinity, determinant 1, then, well, A. Then it is identity. Okay. So. It is identity. So uniqueness. Uniqueness. No. If we can start with something that works as an identity, we can use it. And if we have two distinct T and G prime, that both pushes Z2, Z3, Z4 to W. I can construct T W 2 4 T 2 6 3 4 -1 and T W well and the same but without prime, not with prime. Is it okay? I mean, can you see that they fix them? We have.
But the A times D equals 1 doesn't give you that it's identity.
But if you,
you
use that S1
you
equals
need the ones that S1 equals 1, which you didn't use. If you use S1 equals 2 1s, then you get that it's identity.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Some health code.
Sorry.
So the determinant has nothing to do with S being's identity.
Mm-hmm. Oh, well, we have determinant and A over D.
Okay.
And A, D also one, so. So it's okay. Okay, they both fix their 3 points, so they're similar. I mean, they're just the same. So we don't have any distant T and T prime. They're both like T or T prime or some other notation. Okay. And now, that is cross ratio of that is comma. Now I can define cross ratio of 4 points, like not something that works on points and push it to some other way. I can define it like somehow a number. So is invariant under transformation of T, so that is just the same as T is 1. Geometry. Now I want to show that if I have that my four z's are concyclic, lies on one circle, generalized, if and only if their cross ratio is rational. Real, sorry. So how can I do that? When I'm talking about, and okay, I care about order, so we're talking about ordered set.
What are you talking about now? Or you're trying to define distance?
I'm saying that cross ratio is important because with it I will define distance later.
Okay.
But now I'm going back to school geometry and showing that cross ratio is real if and only if these points are concyclic. Okay. We have two different possibilities of line on circle. Show that that D are only two of that. So that is that is just cross-ratio. I'll present it in that way, or it could be I can leave it. Well, if it is not obvious, do that as exercise that we have only two possibilities. School geometry says that what is z1 minus z1? 1 minus the 2 is that. The 1 minus the 3 is that. So I can look on argument of that and let it be some theta. Why not? And what is z4 minus z2 divided by z4 minus z3? That is also theta because, well, because of geometry. But that is inverse. So that means that argument of z4 minus z3 z4 minus z2 is minus theta. And well, if my cross ratio is some theta, e sum of thetas, and some I don't know a, and well, sum of thetas is zero, then it's real and positive.
Is it a rectangle?
What?
Is it like any? Any 4 points, or is it a rectangle or something?
4 points are concyclic if and only if they have a real real cross ratio, and I'm showing that. Okay, let us think that they are concyclic, so the cross ratio is real. And for that, it is the same. Well, but not the same, that is theta, and that is pi minus theta. And it, that is zero, for cross ratio of, and for cross ratio of rectangular, just usual, it is a, e, I, p, so it is smaller than zero. But they are both real. And
may I just make the remark? What is actually the cross ratio of 4 points? We have 4 points, z1, z2, z3, z4. We always have a unique Möbius transformation that take the first three to 0, 1, infinity, and the value of the fourth will be the cross ratio, right? That's the cross ratio. So now, if they were on the same circle to begin with, and we find a Möbius transformation that takes the first three to 0, 1, and infinity, then the circle must go to the circle which is a
straight line,
which is a straight line plus infinity, which is the real line. And the fourth, then, which is which was on the circle to begin with, must go to the real line, and this is the value of the cross ratio, it must be real. Right, so if we were at the circuit to begin with, we must, the cross ratio must be real, and vice versa. If the fourth is not real, then it's not on the real line plus infinity. Then it was not on the circuit to begin with, on the same circuit that on the same unique circuit that the three first points were. So this is the if and only thing. I mean, as beautiful as this is. That's how I find this convincing as well.
And just to add to what Uri said, the difference between the cross ratio being positive and negative, again, you think of the circle where you have 0, 1, infinity, and you have one A which you want to put somewhere. So this tells you where to put the A, and that, so you know that the cross ratio also preserves the order in which these 4 points sit in the circle.
And this is relevant,
yeah.
I mean, this is
yeah.
equivalent to these two pictures we have on the body.
And, okay, now, using that lemma, that was actually a lemma, theorem, and invariance of cross ratio, that one. I can easily prove that I have T living in automorphism of C hat, then T maps circles and lines to circles and lines, and that's what you said. But we can show that using this lemma, and where is of course we show.
You can continue next week.
Yes, I know, but I'm thinking if
you need to start now a new chapter, then this is a good time.
Yes.
It's a good time to stop, and then I want to say a few words. So I want to volunteer to study and give a talk about a classical results from ancient time, the last century. Called the Nielsen theorem about the automorphism group of the free group. So we have a plan to give like to study into a problem which I found very, very interesting, but.